no, we can use a lot.
I think it's 7:10.
You're in God's time zone.
Okay, so let's go to 1 Timothy 1. 1 Timothy chapter 1. And here's what I'd like to suggest. We'll just go verse by verse, but I want to put up this outline. Hopefully everybody can see this. And I'm just going to leave this up here as we walk through this chapter. And my goal is to talk about what each verse says, how it fits into the overall purpose of Paul's letter. I've also got some translation comparisons I can offer on occasion where a word might be translated and you see something different in a particular translation. So what I'd like to do is just take this one section at a time. So we'll do verses 1 and 2 together, verses 3 through 7, 8 through 11, 12 through 17, and then 18 through 20. I'm going to keep an eye on the clock because I want to respect your time. Maybe you have other appointments after this tonight. Maybe it's just with a pillow, and I respect that too. But I will do my best to stop by about 5 till 9, and that way we can kind of wrap this up. But if you have observations or questions or points of insight, feel free to interrupt me as we're walking through this. So let's read the first couple of verses of 1 Timothy, and what you'll notice is this follows a pattern that we see in Paul's other letters. If I had time, I think I could show you that the salutation or greeting of 1 and 2 Timothy are as Pauline as can be. Now, some might argue, well, that's because it's fake Paul, but they're not only like Paul, they are distinct in a way that I think a forger would have been afraid, based on what I've seen in other pseudepigrapha, to have done. So Paul writes, "Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus, according to the commandment of God our Savior and of Christ Jesus, who is our hope, to Timothy, my true child in the faith, grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord." Does Timothy know Paul? Well, yeah. So why, if this letter is primarily for Timothy, does Paul need to introduce himself in this way? Some have said this is just the way you write. "Dear John, how are you doing? It's been a long time." You remember when we used to write letters? Yeah. Those were good days, weren't they? So there is something to be said for the form here. Depending on the way we count for chronology, Timothy's from Lystra, and he meets Paul in Acts 16. Remember, he's circumcised, unlike Titus, who's not compelled to be circumcised in Galatians 2. So chronologically, if Paul's writing this in the early 60s, and he meets Timothy in Acts 16, which is probably 10, 15 years earlier, Timothy's been a Christian for a while, and he's been preaching for a while, and he's been around Paul for a while. Some of the objections that are made to this letter would be, well, wouldn't an older preacher be insulted by this? Listen, I could be 90 years old, and some of my teachers, if they're still around, I'm going to still address them as brother and respect what they're going to say. It's not about age, it's about the person. And I think Timothy respects Paul. Notice this pronoun, "our." God, our Savior, and Christ Jesus, our hope. Whenever you see the pronoun "our," you've got to ask, is that inclusive or exclusive? And what I mean by that is Paul saying he's our Savior like he and Timothy? That would be inclusive, or actually exclusive, it would exclude us. Or is he saying "our" in a way that we are included in that? And I think this is left open so that I think Paul primarily addresses Timothy, but in the very last verse, I think it's verse 20 of 1 Timothy 6, the "our" there indicates that there are, actually it's the "you." Paul says, what's the prayer at the end of the letter? "Grace be with you all, amen." Is that the last verse? "Grace be with you all, amen." The "you" is y'all in Southern Greek, right? It's plural. So Everything up to that point is singular, Timothy, 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 Timothy. But I think that even though Paul's primarily writing Timothy, he understands that the people that Timothy is ministering to are also going to be beneficiaries of the letter. And so that's a part of our struggle here as well. The reference to Paul's being an apostle, we've already talked about, but it is interesting that this is an expanded reference to his being an apostle. It doesn't just say I'm an apostle. You know, first of all, have you noticed the ordering of the words Jesus Christ? It's not Jesus Christ, is it? It's Christ Jesus. And that is an unusual ordering that we see especially in the pastoral epistles, not only here, but some have argued that this expanded reference is a way of sort of calling us back to the fact that even though Paul and Timothy are friends, and Paul is Timothy's spiritual mentor, this is ultimately tied to God's authority. And I love the way that Paul links the Father and the Son in verse 1. The King James in verse 2, when he references, you might have heard me read this from the New American Standard, a true child by faith, or my true child in the faith. The word there is techno, which means child. The noun weos will be translated son. Now, that's the way the King James reads, and that's okay. I like the King James. My grandmama's Bible, my mama's Bible, and I love them both. A lot of people will be in heaven because of the King James. But it's not a perfect translation, just like the New American Standard is not a perfect translation. But literally, it's with Timothy, a true child by faith. It's as literal as we can render that. And then you have these three words, grace, mercy, and peace, which is a typical greeting. And where does grace, mercy, and peace come from? Yeah, from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord. So there's kinship language here. We talked about that some earlier. And I think there's also language here that helps us to see that ultimately everything that Paul's saying in this letter is tied back to God's power and God's authority. And the way that God and Christ are connected from the very beginning of this, again, you're going to see the Spirit. One criticism of these letters is the Spirit is not referenced as frequently as he is, say, in Romans 8. But I think, first of all, there's no reference to miraculous gifts, which is interesting. As the New Testament era is coming to an end, miraculous activity has clearly slowed quite a bit compared to early on, especially in Acts. But you do have this acknowledgement that Jesus is Lord, and that it's by Jesus' authority that Paul is writing this. So it's clearly a charge to Timothy with some specific goals being laid out for Timothy. And as he continues, we tried in the last session to sort of reconstruct the setting. Some of that, I think, is made evident here, especially in verse 3. And I'm going to just keep going, and I want you to feel free to interject at any point. But let's read verses 3 through 7. Paul writes, "As I urged you upon my departure for Macedonia, remain on at Ephesus so that you may instruct certain men not to teach strange doctrines, nor to pay attention to myths and endless genealogies which give rise to mere speculation rather than furthering the administration of God, which is by faith. But the goal of our instruction is love from a pure heart and a good conscience and a sincere faith. For some men, straying from these things, have turned aside to fruitless discussion, wanting to be teachers of the law, even though they do not understand either what they are saying or the matters about which they make confident assertions." Are we surprised that false teachers are a problem in Ephesus? No. Even though the early church was strong, I mean, you have that scene in Acts 2, 42 through 46, where they are devoting themselves to the apostles' doctrine and prayer, the breaking of bread and fellowship. By Acts 5, you have Ananias and Sapphira. And you have a clear warning, even in the teaching of Jesus, that wolves in sheep's clothing would arrive. and that they would try to destroy. That's part of the job of an elder, is to protect the flock. So, one question, though. Usually when we read letters of Paul, there's a prayer of thanksgiving. Where's the prayer of thanksgiving in 1 Timothy?
It's further down.
Okay, yeah, he's going to give us that prayer further down, starting in verse 12. But it's almost a way, it's not really a prayer of thanksgiving for Timothy. It's a prayer of thanksgiving for what God's done for Paul. Because that's where Paul sort of gets autobiographical and talks about, again, his story. So, some have asked, was Paul in Ephesus? Or was he on his way to Macedonia at this point? It seems that he's on his way to Macedonia, according to verse 3, but this is where translations vary. The NIV, at the end of that phrase in verse 3, says, any longer. Upon my departure from Macedonia any longer, while the ASV of 1901 says, while I was going to Macedonia. So it seems like there's some confusion about exactly where Paul is. But what's not confusing is he's left Timothy at Ephesus with a job to do. And that job is to proclaim the truth. And as you start to see specifically what Paul's urging Timothy to do, this is what happens in every letter of the New Testament. People are going to ask, what do we know about these false teachers? And based on what's said, it seems like there are some Jewish influences here. What would make us think that there might be some Jewish influences among these false teachers?
Genealogy.
That's a biggie, right? I mean, the first 17 verses of the New Testament are genealogy, Luke 3. Not only genealogies, endless genealogies. Oh, that sounds bad. You know. And then what about verse 7? What do they want to be?
Teachers of the law.
They want to be teachers of the law. And that's a clear reference back to the law of Moses. And what follows that in verses 8 through 11 is sort of an excursus on the law. About the law. Where, like Paul does in Romans 7, he wants us to make sure we understand the law is not bad. Right? The abuse of the law is bad. The law leads to bad things, but the reason it leads to bad things is because of us, not because of the lawgiver of the law. And if somebody challenges you on that, I was speaking at a Spanish-English conference a couple of years ago, and the guy got really upset when I said that. The law, legalism is bad. I said, well, I didn't say legalism was good. I said the law is good. The reason I feel confident saying that is because of Romans 7, verse 12. Paul describes the law in Romans 7:12 with three words, actually four words. The law is good, it is holy and acceptable. I guess three words. What time is it? Three words. Holy, acceptable, and good. So it's the abuse of the law. So these troublemakers, we might be tempted to say, well, they're clearly Jews, but we're in Asia Minor. And that's a very mixed area. And so there might be some Jewish influences. There might be, as we'll see later in this letter, some Gnostic influences. Gnosticism is the idea that, I can't take long on this, but you're trying to work your way up to God, and there are basically aeons or levels of knowledge. Looks like an arrow. But you're trying as a spiritual to get as close to God, and Gnosis is just a Greek word for knowledge. So the more secret gnosis you can get, the more spiritual you are. And this is an idea that's evident in Colossians. I think it's also evident in 1 Timothy. And this is not tied to Judaism. This is tied to the Greco-Roman pantheon of gods. I mean, this is where you see Zeus and Hermes and these other gods and goddesses acting like pagans and the way they compete for the loyalty of people. And so I think one interesting implication here is Paul knows these people well, and we're not surprised by that. He spent 3 years there in Acts chapter 19. That's a lot of negative. Look at verse 5 for something positive, and then we'll move on. What are the, in verse 5, it might be hard to see this in English, but What's the goal of our instruction? I think Paul's saying, Timothy, you and I are teaching the same stuff in love. What's the goal? Three things, and they're all governed by the same preposition in Greek. The preposition ek, which most English translations are going to translate from. Maybe your Bible includes that in verse 5. The goal of our instruction is love from three sources. Pure heart, good conscience,
sincere faith.
Sincere faith. Wow, preach. That's a foundation, right? Now, the New Living Translation there says genuine faith. The King James says faith unfeigned, which is the same way the ASV reads there. But the idea is we're coming at this with honesty. Others, verse 6, are literally missing the mark and are involved in empty talk or fruitless discussion, as the New American Standard renders it. And they are incompetent, and yet they are speaking with great confidence, even though they have no idea what they're talking about.
You're missing out on vain jangling.
Yeah, I don't want to miss out on some jangling. That's why I would just say that, you know, some people get into really heated conversations about which translation to read. I want you to read comparatively. Maybe find three or four that you can read. It's good to have a favorite. I generally will choose the one most people in the congregation. I like the New American Standard. I do like the New King James. It's usually what's in pews where I go. But I like to still read comparatively. I would marry one and make the claim that it's the only one you can read. I think that's easy to disprove. Yes, sir.
I'm not real bright, and I don't think I'm real tired right now. When you're reading from your Bible, I'm having a really hard time following it, like King James reading. God is confusing to me. I guess my theory, I'm not saying to change, but you know, I'll paddle on. But I think congregations should somehow come to agreement to basically follow one translation. So everybody's reading the same thing, cuts down a lot of confusion and stuff. Regardless of that, hopefully, yeah. Good translation. But you know, it's confusing when there's several different translations.
Yeah, I know congregations that have done that. I think part of what makes that difficult is just the diversity of the membership. But I think if an eldership were to say, we want our guy preaching from this translation, I have a translation tree, and I would ask that eldership consider four things. The base text that it's built on, the motive of the translator, the translation philosophy, and the readership. In other words, the grade reading level. Most Americans read at the seventh grade reading level, even if they're college educated. And I'm not saying the best-selling Bibles are the best Bibles, but most of those are written on the seventh grade reading level. The reason I like the New American Standard, I'm not saying it's the be-all, end-all. And this, I'm using the, part of the reason there's confusion here is because I'm using the Greek text too, to teach from. But the ASV of 1901 was a pretty good English translation, and the New American Standard was updated in 96 to try to the best of the ability of the translators, who were a pretty diverse group of people, represent that text. But I understand. I share that frustration sometimes too.
So you read it basically from the New American Standard?
Initially, and then I'm working from the Greek. So I'll try to do better with making sure we know what verse we want. Let's look at verses 8 through 11. Let's work out.
I got a question.
Oh, yeah. Yes, sir.
I was looking here at, do you think one reason why Paul promotes Timothy so much there in 1 and 2 is to kind of give him some authority because he's going to, you know, basically rebuke these people, right? What they're doing, you know what I'm saying? Like, calling him a true son of the faith, and
think I heard all of that, but.
I didn't, can you repeat that, please?
Yeah.
Oh,
sorry.
I was thinking about in the verse two that Paul elevates Timothy, right? True son in the faith, or, you know, whatever the translation is. And so I was asking, do you think one of the reasons why is he's kind of given Timothy some authority, so that when the others read this letter, as you, you know, mentioned, that the people will know, well, yeah, Timothy is saying this to us, and hey, it comes from Paul, you know, Paul's an apostle and kind of giving him this authority.
I think the connection between Paul and Timothy is probably well known, especially in Ephesus, where they spent quite a bit of time together. I'm pretty sure the Ephesians were exposed to this letter. You know, I don't know. A lot of the Gentiles would have been illiterate, so reading was as much for the ear as it was for the eye. They probably heard this rather loud. So I think any idea that Timothy's authority is directly related to Paul, but also directly related to the proclamation of the Word of God, assuming that as a one who probably has had hands laid on him based on what Paul reports in Acts, that he's able to speak and to serve with the level of authority that is evident. But I think you're right, that when Paul says this, in the mind of some of those hearers or readers, they're thinking, okay, well, maybe that let no one despise you in your youth was also a problem for Timothy that we'll see later in 1 Timothy 4. So Paul said to Timothy, you've got a job to do. There are some people here who are clearly straying from the truth. They are claiming things they can't back up. And then, notice in verses 8 through 11, I think the reason he talks about the lawful use of the law is because these false teachers are abusing the law. They are making claims that are not true, and they do not know what they're talking about. So let's read verses 8 through 11. But we know that the law is good if one uses it lawfully, realizing the fact that law is not made for a righteous person, but for those who are lawless and rebellious, for the ungodly and sinners, for the unholy and profane, for those who kill their fathers or mothers, for murderers and immoral men, and homosexuals and kidnappers and liars and perjurers, and whatever else is contrary to sound teaching, according to the glorious gospel of the blessed God with which I have been entrusted. That's 1 Timothy 1, verses 8 through 11. When he says, we know, in verse 8, that the law is good, that's inclusive. Timothy, you know. How does Timothy know that the law is good?
He was brought up in the faith as well.
He had a faithful mother and a faithful grandmother, Cyrillus and Eunice. I think this also, there's a bit of a play on words here that I wish I could make clear. The word for law is nomos, and the word for rightfully or legitimately or properly or lawfully, I like how some English translations here will say in verse 8, we know that the law is good if one uses it lawfully. Anybody have a translation that says that?
KJV.
Yeah, great. That's an intentional play on words, because in the Greek, the word, the adverb is connected to the noun. It's the same root. And that's a great way to show in English what's going on there in the language. We know that the law is good if you use it lawfully. You know, if you use it in the way God intended for you to use it, and clearly these false teachers are not doing that. Not just Judaizers who are making a big deal about these genealogies, but a lot of what, and this is where I think this list, this vice list, in verses 9 and 10, you see the lawless, rebellious, ungodly, unholy, profane, murderers. If you look at 1 Timothy 1, 9 and 10, and compare that with the Ten Commandments, in Exodus 20, especially verses 12 through 16, it's almost a direct echo of a violation of those commandments. These false teachers are taking the name of the Lord in vain. They have erected false idols. They are murderers. They are liars. They are the opposite of what, from the very beginning, this isn't just something that Jesus taught. From the very beginning, when Jesus fulfills the law, remember what Jesus says in Matthew 5:17? In the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus says, "Do not think that I came to destroy or to abolish the law. I came to fulfill the law." And so, I think when he mentions all of these things, it's clearly a reference to the wickedness of that world and of our world. Similar to what you get in Romans 1, all the terrible, especially verses 30 and 31, things that describe this world in which we now live. But contrast that with, verse 11, the glorious gospel of the blessed God with which I have been entrusted. I love the passive language there. I've been given this gospel. I didn't make this gospel up. I didn't write this gospel. This is God's gospel. I've been given this gospel. I've been entrusted with it. And that's what sound teaching is. Sound teaching is reflective of the teaching that our sound God has given us, right? And so there's a clear contrast between both the reason why Paul has taught and the result of Paul's teaching, and the reason why these false teachers have taught and the result of their teaching. And Jesus says in Matthew 7, by their fruit you'll know them. Paul says something similar in Galatians 5. There are weeds and there are fruit. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Right? It's fruit. And don't you love that song? And so there's a contrast there. So it's not that verses 8 through 11 are just a random allusion to the law. It's that the law is good, and that is reflected in what Jesus fulfilled in the ministry that Paul has tried to carry out. And now, the ministry he's calling, God through Paul is calling Timothy to carry out. And so, if that's true, and I love the way Paul, the Holy Spirit through Paul makes this clear. If what you've just said is true, Paul, back it up. Okay, let me give you a positive example and a negative example. The positive example is my story, verses 12 through 17. The negative example, you know, I'm going to name names. The negative example is Hymenaeus and Alexander. And at first glance, we think, who? I don't believe I've met them. But when we look at Acts and we look at the rest of these two letters, we know these guys. They're infamous in Ephesus for opposing Paul. And I think, as I've already indicated, Alexander, even after this was written, and I don't know, maybe even in response to this, is going to make life even worse in a worldly way of thinking for Paul. So what's the positive example? Let's look at verses 12 through 17 in 1 Timothy 1, starting in verse 12. I thank Christ Jesus our Lord, who has strengthened me, because he considered me faithful, putting me into service, even though I was formerly a blasphemer and a persecutor and a violent aggressor, yet I was shown mercy because I acted ignorantly in unbelief. And the grace of our Lord was more than abundant with the faith and love which are found in Christ Jesus. It is a trustworthy statement deserving full acceptance that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, among whom I am foremost of all. Yet for this reason I found mercy, so that in me as the foremost, Jesus Christ might demonstrate his perfect patience as an example for those who would believe in him for eternal life. Now to the King, eternal, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. Don't you love how Paul sometimes just burst out in praise for God? That prayer language is always at the heart of Paul as one who knows how to respond. Look back at verse 12. I thank Christ Jesus our Lord. Literally, I have thanksgiving because of what God has empowered me with the ability to do. And I think what Paul's doing here is he's I used to have a teacher who would say to the preacher's students, something I think we all need to be reminded of from time to time, the church has a savior and none of you are it. Paul's saying, God's accomplished some things in my ministry, but every time I think about that, I think about what I used to be and the change that God has brought about in my life and in my ministry. And if you look at he mentions mercy twice. He mentions mercy in verse 13. He mentions mercy again in verse 16. He mentions patience, his perfect patience in verse 16. I view this as Paul saying, these things happen despite my best efforts, despite my failure, what I used to be, right? Acts 26, 4 through 11, we mentioned earlier. So before I met Jesus, I was ignorant. I was committed, but I was ignorant, and I was violent. But after I've encountered the Lord, by his grace, because of his calling, because of what he sought to accomplish in me, there's been success. Now look at that phrase in verse 15. Do you have a translation that says something like, it's a trustworthy statement at the beginning of verse 15? Anybody's translation?
This is a faithful saying.
A faithful saying.
And worthy of all acceptance.
We're going to see that five times. In 1st, 2nd Timothy, and Titus, that exact phrase. And every time we see this, it's a way of commending something that Paul believes to be an obvious truth that God has revealed. So what's the obvious truth that God has revealed that he makes reference to in verse 15?
Christ Jesus, to save sinners.
Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. You can take that to the bank. That's a trustworthy statement. That's a faithful saying. Both of those are great translations here. But then what does he add? How does he personalize that?
He's the chief.
I'm the chief. I'm the foremost. I'm at the head of the class in a bad way.
Can I make you a little scared?
It does. The only thing that brings me comfort is the transformation that we see God bringing about in his life. But yeah, he is the second greatest preacher who ever lived, second only to our Lord. But I think this shows, isn't it easy sometimes to get puffed up and people patting on the back and, boy, you're so great. And, you know, well, I think Paul's attitude is, if you think I'm special, just wait till you meet the Lord. He's the reason. I'm the chief of sinners. And maybe that's the reason why in verse 17 he burst forth in praise. One of the things I like to highlight is sort of like the language of Hebrews 13:8. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Every one of these adjectives in verse 17, to the King, eternal, immortal, invisible, the only God. I mean, what he's saying here is God is above all creation. He is great in every way. He's the King of the ages, quite literally, which means past, present, future. It's all under God's authority. It's all under God's power. And so why be caught up in wanting to discuss these endless genealogies or be considered an expert? I think that James 3:1 warning, by the way, that's in here. Let not many of you be teachers, my brothers, knowing that you will incur a stricter judgment. That's a serious warning. I mean, that's the kind of verse that keeps you awake at night, making sure, okay, you know, I want to just teach the Word of God. I don't want to get in the way of that. I don't want to pollute that. And then, in contrast to that positive, look at verses 18 through 20. This command I entrust to you, Timothy, my son, in accordance with the prophecies previously made concerning you, that by them you fight the good fight, keeping faith and a good conscience, which some have rejected and suffered shipwreck in regard to their faith. Among these are Hymenaeus and Alexander, whom I have handed over to Satan, so that they will be taught not to blaspheme. Wow. Lot to unpack here, some strong language. Notice first of all the appeal, like we had back in verse 2, to sonship, Timothy, my child or my son, depending on your translation. The Greek here is technon, which is literally child. But son's appropriate just because we know he's a male child, so that's a place where I think we understand what translations are doing. There's military imagery here. Where's the military imagery in verse 18?
Charge.
Yeah, have we ever heard some fights are good? Some fights are worthwhile? Some fights are God-honoring? I don't like fights. I don't want to pick a fight. But what's a good fight? Does Paul mention anything about a good fight at the end of 2 Timothy 4? He's balding. Isn't it interesting that in 1 Timothy 1 he says, fight the good fight, and in 2 Timothy 4 he says, I have fought the good fight. So I like the fact that Paul practices what he preaches. And what he's urging Timothy to do, he's done, right? Some fights are good. What about these prophecies? Prophecy is forthtelling, not only foretelling, but it's a forthtelling of the truth. And Timothy ought not be surprised that there are some who have rejected the truth, that there are some who are going to cause difficulty. Not only should Timothy know that that's been prophesied, Timothy lived it in service with Paul. Have we read in verse 19 about sincere faith and a good conscience before? What about back up in verse 5? The goal of our instruction is love and a pure heart and a good conscience and a sincere faith. Here in verse 19 he says, keeping faith and a good conscience. Remembering what got you here, Timothy. Holding on to what's true. Shipwreck. Some have rejected and suffered shipwreck in regard to their faith. Why bring up a shipwreck now? Well, 2 Corinthians 11, verse 25, what did Paul experience? Shipwreck. Right before writing this letter. We know in Acts 27 he experiences a similar event when he's stranded at Malta, and of course Publius and some of the other leaders there are baptized, and he survives the serpent bite. But this graphic language of war and shipwreck, I think, is a way of contrasting the stability to be found in truth with the unrest and uncertainty that's found in rejecting truth.
Is that literally a nautical term in the Greek there?
The verb is apothemeomai, which is only used twice in the New Testament, and both times it's referring to a literal shipwreck. I should say the other occasion, the 2 Corinthians 11, 25, that's referring to a literal shipwreck. So I think this is a metaphor.
Yeah.
We might say train wreck, but I think Timothy would have been confused by that.
I just asked that because my margin says ruined. But
yeah, it's and that would be an example of, you know, I think about a lot of Bible translators fear, would a reader understand shipwreck? I would hope so. But let's make it even plainer.
Right.
Ruined. One of my favorite translations is, it's online, it's called the Net Bible. And the reason I like it is because it has 64,000 footnotes. And it's free. The Net Bible. And the reason I like it with all those footnotes is because I'm a nerd. And they explain why they translated it the way they did. And in the footnotes, they describe if there's a variation or how they rendered the word. And I just like to be able to see behind the curtain. And I'm not saying it's a... I've never preached from it. Because it's not something people are going to have. But I just like to use it in my personal studies sometimes.
Is it only online?
It was printed. But it's out of print, and I saw a copy on sale on Amazon the other day for $400. So I'm using the online version. I'm on a preacher budget, and I'm blessed, and I'm not complaining. Now, what do we know about Hymenaeus and Alexander? We do have a reference to Alexander back in Acts 19, verse 33. And we will have another reference to him in 2 Timothy 4, verses 14 and 15. Again, it's Acts 19, verse 33, and 2 Timothy 4, verses 14 and 15. And if I'm reading this correctly, now there's talk, is this the same Alexander? Well, it's the same Ephesus, and it's the same warning. If we're correct in this, this means that Alexander has been causing problems for Paul since the third missionary journey and will continue to cause problems for Paul even after this letter gets written. What's Paul's advice? Or what does Paul say he's done?
Delivered them safely.
Delivered them, handed them over, paradidomi, literally hand them over, deliver them. It's the language used to describe making a delivery. Do we ever see that language handing over to Satan used elsewhere in the New Testament?
1 Corinthians 5.
1 Corinthians 5, 5. I believe it's the verse. In the context of church discipline. I preached on that Sunday night at Estes. The gospel meeting had a 1 o'clock service, so I was able to be at Estes at 5 o'clock. Preach there Sunday night on church discipline. And I think a lot of people have concerns about discipline because they don't understand what motivates discipline. And what's motivating Paul to say, handing them over to Satan? Is it that he wants them to be lost? He wants them to be separated from God? Well, according to Matthew 18, 15 through 20, and 1 Corinthians 5, and even in the context of other passages, in 2 Thessalonians 3, where we read about this same kind of problem, Galatians 6, bear one another's burdens, and thereby fulfill the law of Christ. The motivation is love and restoration and a desire that these individuals be restored. And I understand that we live in a world where sometimes that's hard because they might go down the street, be associated with another group that doesn't represent what's right, that doesn't do away with our responsibility. But the reason he's handed them over to Satan is they made the choice to follow Satan. And he desires that they be restored. And he even says that, right, at the end of this, so that they will be taught not to blaspheme. It's not just punitive. I had a student the other day asking if God was evil. And I was thinking, where is this coming from? And the question was because of hell, you know. Satan didn't make hell. God created hell. Matthew 25, 46. And the place prepared for the devil and his angels. And they were saying, how could God make hell? And I said, because God is just. And that punitive measure is something that's warranted by the decisions of those who are there. And it doesn't mean that God is unjust. But Paul's motivation here is not, boy, you know, sometimes we're not careful, is kill them with kindness. Just, you know, cause them to hate you by being nice to them. That's not what Paul's saying. Paul's saying, we want these men to know what's right. And you can't get there by looking the other way and pretending like the destruction that they've caused in the body isn't that big a deal. I think they are actually illustrations of what he warns about back up in verses 3 through 7.
Is he talking about church discipline here in verse 20?
I think when he says, I've handed them over to Satan, it's like what he says in 1 Corinthians 5. Although I'm absent, I've already judged them. That's his, do not judge lest you be judged, Matthew 7:1, is unrighteous snap judgment. In verse 6 of that chapter, Jesus talks about our need to make wise discernments.
It doesn't seem like in the Acts reference that Alexander is a Christian, but maybe he converted?
That's a good question.
If he did, he's still a silversmith making idols for...
Maybe the connection is treat him as a Gentile and a tax collector. Whether he is in Christ or not,
shake the dust off your feet.
He was still delivered no matter what in the world he is. And delivered him over to Satan. Now, if he converted later, okay.
A lot of people had even thought, maybe he's a person of influence, like Diotrephes and Thurinus, which is a bit different because it's pretty clear that Diotrephes was a, maybe even an elder who refused to, unlike Demetrius, he refused the preacher who's coming through. But yeah, I think that's a good question.
It says in 2 Timothy, he did him much harm. So he was definitely working against the church. I was thinking about the sorcerer in Acts. No,
Elymas.
Elymas.
He blinded him.
He actually blinded him, you know. Obviously not a Christian, but just thwarting what Paul was trying to do.
Yeah, I think that was at Cyprus when I first started being Barnabas. Elymas was the ruler of the island, and Paul fixed his gaze on him.
I was thinking about him earlier. I wonder if he argued that religion wasn't set in stone yet, so you can't blind me like these.
I don't know, but you know, I think this is a good time to be reminded of the fact that love doesn't always feel good. It doesn't always give me the answer I want. Sometimes it might give me the answer I need. And I would also just throw this out. Discipline is not only corrective, it is something that gets us to, it's a daily disciplining. I mean, the body of Christ serves as a constant corrective. And sometimes I think we only think about discipline with regard to this fellowship or getting to that point. That's clearly a part of that discussion, but maybe if it was in the context of I'm sharpening you and you're sharpening me, and our elders are responsible in overseeing us and shepherding and sharpening us, then it wouldn't be viewed as such an intrusion, where in most religious-minded people in our country, it's individual. Religion is individualized and private. Don't you hate it when there's an election and they get asked that question? Will your religion impact your decision-making? I'm thinking, how could it not? It's at the core of it's in your DNA. How could it not? You can't put it on the shelf, but that's the way we think. And that's why, how dare you? I'm just not attending there anymore. Now it's, were you really a part of it to start with? Would be the question. Yeah.
What do you think the word blasphemy, would it have the same connotation today as back then? What's your opinion on that?
I think people would know, either in paganism or in Judeo-Christian values, what it meant to desecrate or defile or mock a god.
Verbally and physically?
It could be commission or omission. But the verb here in verse 20 is literally blasphemeo. We transliterate that. Mm-hmm. So there's no doubt. And I like the way the King James, the ESV, both render this, learn not to blaspheme. You know, some are going to translate this, but they be taught not to blaspheme. Okay, I guess those are the same sentiments. But so whether they're in Christ or not, what are they doing? They're blaspheming. They're opposing the truth. They're causing harm to those who are in Christ.
Most people view the word blaspheme as yakking with the mouth, but you blaspheme both verbally and by action. It's not limited to one. When I don't do what God says, and I've turned my life back to Satan, I'm blaspheming.
That's right.
Whether I say anything or not.
Just like idolatry.
Yeah.
Idolatry isn't just about wood and stone statues. It's about being committed to something other than God.
Yeah.
With my words and my life.
Could I go back to Alexander?
Yeah,
Acts 16, or excuse me, 19.
Yeah.
I'll get this right. Says that he was a Jew.
That's right.
And that he was going to stand up and say some things. And the audience, which was Gentile, saw that he was a Jew and started shouting and would not listen to him. So.
I think the majority of that audience would have really struggled to understand the difference between a Jew and a Christian at that time, sadly. Something that came about later, but I don't know that we could demonstrate this without a shadow of a doubt, but it's just interesting to see the continuous rollout that Andrew plays in opposing Paul and opposing Jesus.
I'm 76 years old and I've never really made that connection on that, and I appreciate it.
I heard someone claim that maybe a person was Paul's born in the flesh. I don't think so, because even though in 2 Corinthians 12 he does describe this as a messenger of Satan, the word thorn there, skalops in Greek, is an impersonal object, so maybe, but I do think people can be thorns in the flesh. And we love them anyway, but we have to stand for truth, even if that means handing them over to Satan.
Right? Do you think in verse 18, this is referring back to maybe verse 3 or from 3 to 11?
With regard to this command?
This.
Yeah. The command is at the end of verse 18 that you literally make war in a good fight with them.
Okay, so you think it's referring to
The antecedent, the connection, and I don't want to be a major nerd, although that comes naturally, but the connection here in the case number and gender of the noun is good fight. It's the antecedent of this. Watch the burnout. So the command is fight a good fight. Fight the good fight is the command. Hey, let me just offer a couple of things. I know time's up, but I know we spent quite a bit of time in intro tonight, but I'm ready for 6 o'clock tomorrow night to get here. I want to get into the text, and the heart of this letter is really tomorrow night, chapters 2 through 4. We just touched the hem of the garment, but chapter 2 is the most controversial chapter in the letter. Chapter 3 is probably the one that we see discussed the most with regard to church organization, elders and deacons. Chapter 4 offers a beautiful warning both about apostasy and what makes a good evangelist. And so if you feared that some of our discussion tonight was impractical with regard to Marcion and Gnosticism, we're going to get to the bread and butter tomorrow night in this chapter, these three chapters, and so can't wait. I know that we're out of time. I'd like to have a word of prayer, and then maybe you want to stay around and talk more about 1 Timothy. I'm here until Saturday night. So let's pray together. Father, we love you. There's no doubt that you love us from what you've revealed and your perfect plan revealed in your perfect word. We thank you for the opportunity we've had tonight just to study together and to be encouraged by your word, and help us to study to show ourselves approved, and help us to seek to glorify you with our words and our lives. We thank you for your servant Paul, your servant Timothy, for all of those Christians in that time and place who are seeking to do your will. Help us to seek to do your will and to stand for truth and to oppose Paul's teaching even now. Help us to represent you even when it's difficult, and to trust that the promises that you've made will continue to come to fruition in our lives. Bless us with a good night's rest. We thank you for the opportunities you've afforded us today. I look forward, if you will, to those opportunities tomorrow. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.